The last speaker before the coffee break is Egill Arnarsson, who studied philosophy, history, Latin at the University of Iceland and at the University of Rennes in France and in Kiel in Germany. He has written articles on philosophy and translated a number of texts by contemporary French philosophers into Icelandic. He currently chairs the Icelandic Philosophical Association, Félag áhugamanna um heimspeki, and he is going to react to the talk of Nicolas Bourriaud yesterday and relate it to the exhibition in some way.
Yes, I'll discuss some themes from yesterday's lecture on the role of art today, but I'll draw heavily on Bourriaud's last book called The Radicant and make some philosophical connections in the process. Nicolas Bourriaud's book, The Radicant, is clearly conceived as a response to postmodernism and the detrimental effects he thinks it has had on art criticism today. What may have been conceived as an anti-essentialist theory in general has in practice turned out to be mainly an essentialist perspective, at least within the field of arts. Through postmodernism, the art critic's attention has shifted from the artwork itself or the individuality of the artist to her origins, to the group she is essentially supposed to belong to. And as such groups, for example, ethnic or linguistic minorities, risk being dissolved in the strong currents of globalization, this perspective on art consists above all, Bourriaud claims, in showing the artist as a potential victim of global shifts and flows, in extremis in portraying her as belonging to an endangered species. Bourriaud criticizes this view for various reasons. First of all, there's of course something degrading with the obsession of asking where the artist comes from instead of being curious about the ideas she is trying to convey or to materialize. Secondly, as Bourriaud shows, postmodernism can be seen as a logical reaction to the end of an economic era in the 70s, which was based on the false assumption that we would always enjoy an abundance of energy sources. An economic era which was contemporary with 20th century modernism in arts and its fascination for unbridled energy. The loss of all historical destination with the end of modernist radicalism first triggered a phase of mourning which was characterized by a constant play with various historical styles. With the end of the Cold War, however, post-colonial multiculturalism followed this mourning phase as a parallel process to economic globalization and the emergence of new markets. But this multiculturalism, however, is simply no longer an adequate description or explanation of the most recent currents in contemporary art. As a critical model, multiculturalism is in crisis. And this Bourriaud shows in his description of the works of various artists from all parts of the world. So what is now to replace multiculturalism? At least there is clearly no going back to 20th century modernism. Despite the demise of postmodernism, modernism remains obsolete. It was a grand narrative which is just as unconvincing as it has been in the last decades. Modernism is also replete with unacceptable elements, such as a universalism based upon a local Western culture that can only manifest itself in other parts of the world as colonialist. Then modernism was fascinated by the idea of erasing the past in order to construct a new identity by eradicating old roots and implanting new ones, as radicality can be described. But such a new beginning is simply unthinkable, Bourriaud argues, since with, to quote, the great cluttering of our era which is reflected in the chaotic proliferation of cultural products, images, media, and commentaries, we no longer have even an imaginary form or concept with which to conceive of a new beginning, much less a rational alternative to the environment in which we live. Thus, it comes as no surprise that all radicality seems to have vanished from art. And if the term is still used to describe certain recent works, it must be confessed that this is the dual effect of laziness and nostalgia. End quote. What is interesting is that Bourdieu nevertheless pleads allegiance or faithfulness, quote, to the program opened up by modernism as an event in the realm of ideas, while picking and choosing among its part. End quote. Thus, modernism still lives as a truth event in the sense given by the French philosopher Alain Badiou, which I would tend to explain as a universalizable ideal, an eternal ideal that requires different forms for different circumstances or epochs. Apparently, what Bourdieu seems to have here in mind is the ideal of a global art based on a true universalism and not a culturally imperialistic one, which would replace the multiculturalist essentialism inherent to postmodernism. This is what alter modernity and the radicant is all about. What I was particularly happy to read or to find in the Radicant was a philosophical or even a metaphysical grounding of Bourdieu's dismissal of someone's identity being defined by his origins, of his dismissal of modernist and other grand narratives, and for his appraisal of precariousness, both as a mode of being and as an adequate subject of art. These are all themes that were mentioned in his talk yesterday. This theoretical base he finds, among others, in one of the last writings of the French philosopher Louis Althusser, whom Bourdieu also discussed extensively yesterday, that is his fragmentary ideas on what he calls aleatory materialism or of materialism of the encounter, a text not discussed yesterday. These are some core insights Althusser claims to have tried earlier to deduce from Marx's works, or perhaps rather to read into Marx's works. Building on the atomism of the ancient Greek philosopher Epicurus and his describing the emergence of all things from the encounters between swerving atoms and their subsequent capacity to form lasting things, Althusser suggests that the swerve or deviation is the principle of all reality. Everything depends on contingent encounters, natural laws included, as well as moral or aesthetic. They are all precarious, and a new encounter could dismantle them and eventually will, just as every other settled order of things. There is thus no great origin or reason of all things, or a destination where they are heading for out of necessity. There has simply always been a void filled with erratic atoms. To quote Althusser, we shall say that the materialism of the encounter is also contained in its entirety in the negation of the end, of all teleology. Be it rational, secular, moral, political, or aesthetic. Finally, we shall say that the materialism of the encounter is the materialism not of the subject, be it God or the proletariat, but of a process that has no subject, yet imposes on the subject, individual or others, which it dominates the order of its development with no assignable end. End quote. Thus, an aleatory Marxist would have to accept that the grand narrative of the triumph of the proletariat does not mean the end of history, but at most only the end of the history of capitalism, an end which may be only temporary and not definitive. In other words, there can be only temporary meaning within history, but history as such has no particular meaning. What conclusions are we to draw from this philosophy in the context of art? According to Bourdieu, quote, an aesthetic of aleatory materialism is of course opposed to modernist teleology, which asserted that the history of art had a direction and an origin. And later, artists who are working today with an intuitive idea of culture as toolbox know that art has neither an origin nor a metaphysical destination, and that the work they exhibit is never a creation, but an instance of post-production. Like the materialist philosopher whose portrait Althusser sketches, they know neither where the train is coming nor where it is going, and they don't care. They get on. End quote. Bourdieu sees this migratory state as an increasingly emblematic one for our times. This is not only the financial aspect of globalization. Every year, 10 million migrants or refugees are added to the millions already living in such conditions. People have to be able to reroute again and again, and can now be said to have various origins and only temporary destinations. The same goes for artists. They deal with actuality in working on the precariousness of all identities by showing that there is always an alternative to the settled order of things, that a particular order is only contingent, and that their own roots are simply temporary. Bourdieu develops different concepts for the artistic model, such as semiunodes that viatorize the roots, put them into motion and re-enroute them in new places by the means of translation, and in so doing becoming new kinds of creole. Of course, you'll have to read the book to get a better picture of what it means to be such a radicant artist, as he calls it. But in this process, artists do not dissolve their identity, but develop it, since, quote, it is movement that ultimately permits the formation of an identity, end quote. If I try, with my meager competence in art theory, to look for examples of radicancy, or of being radicant, in the works here exposed, it seems to me that some rather deal with or put into motion the roots of the Icelandic painting tradition, more than the roots, say, of being Icelandic in general. Einar Garibaldi shows us a painting of Kjarval, but locked into a wooden box, ready to be sent to some museum or stored up. Thor Vigfusson plays with a modernist painting of Svavar Guðnason, breaking a fragment of it, and Tommy Magnusson making its composites fluid in a video installation. And Einar Falur Ingólfsson takes a photo of the farm and surroundings of Snartartunga from the same perspective as painted by William Collingwood more than a century before, contrasting Collingwood's image with today's reality. However, we find in the title of Rúrí's reproduction of an old photography of an Icelandic girl, it's called That Day, probably an attempt to make an opaque figure from the past concern us in some way. What was that girl thinking or experiencing that particular day? Olaf Nordahl confronts us with photos of sheep, one of them always two-headed, on Icelandic lava moss with snowy mountains in the background, certainly very Icelandic themes. But is this radicant art? I'm not sure I would be able to respond to the question. It seems to depend on the artist's intention, to some extent at least. We can also ask ourselves, if these works are to be considered as radicant, do the artists try to entangle the roots with others, with other roots? Again, I simply don't think that I'm able to judge, but it would at least be surprising if they did not do so. But I leave it to the audience and the artists themselves to think about it. Now, the radicant starts as a description of globally emerging currents in the art scene, but every now and then, the book prescribes a particular politics in art, broadly speaking. That is, it gives indications of what kind of art would be interesting or valuable in our present situation. In the discussion yesterday, Bourdieu was asked about this ambiguity between being descriptive and prescriptive at the same time. And probably he was quite right in not finding it contradictory, that it simply depended on the context. What Bourdieu repeatedly hints at as a strategy for Radicant artists is something he names exodus. As you know, this biblical term concerns the escape of the Jewish people from their plight in Egypt. Bourdieu cites Sloterdijk in this context, who writes that the exodus represents the moment, quote, when all things must be reevaluated in terms of their transportability, even if it means running the risk of leaving behind everything that is too heavy for human beings to carry. This meant to pass from cultural sedentariness to a nomadic universe, end quote. And this by the means of translating old reference points into a new context. 20th century modernism was also such an exodus, Bourdieu claims. The artistic traditions of the whole world were discovered and re-evaluated from this perspective, from the modernist perspective. Today, he goes on to say, the perspective is reversed, and the question is how art can finally define and inhabit a globalized culture against the standardization presupposed by globalization. Economic globalization simultaneously standardizes our world and causes a constant unrest within it. Radicant artists who take the political challenge this implies seriously practice translation and organize the discussions that will give rise to a new common intelligibility. They must therefore set things in motion again, start a counter-movement by beginning a new exodus, Bourdieu concludes. At this point, I only want to make two concluding remarks. It is interesting to note that in their works, Michael Hart and Tony Negri also use the term exodus in a similar way. It is by leaving empire or capitalism in postmodern times through an exodus that the multitude or proletariat in postmodern times defies empire, which leads then to a final victory over it. But in comparison to Hart and Negri, Bourdieu's exodus seems to remain an artistic project, that is, of connecting various routes through translation and so to create a dialogue. Hart and Negri, however, go much further in envisioning a democratic rule of the multitude over all things common, owned in common by people. Secondly, I wonder if the political focus on art isn't too big in Bourdieu's book. I'm not saying that art shouldn't be political or that it should be so only up to a certain extent, etc. But one may wonder whether we run the risk of valuing art too much for its political message or utility. I'm not suggesting that this is something Bourdieu could be accused of doing in practice, but his book, for all its virtues, gives the impression of overrating this element in art. Thank you.